Love you, brother, and put your house in order. I hear those things many, many times. And I remember when this place used to have hundreds of people every day. I came, and I expecting some of the members show up sometimes, or every time there is an opening, doors, which are open all the time. And I know we are in a perilous time. The world is in chaos. We never know. One day we'll be here, and next day we might be not. So give us intelligent wisdom, knowledge, that way we can see you anywhere and any place. Keep feeding us with the mysteries. We need know more about you, because this teaching, there is no end. So thank you so much. And I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Search for him while he is near, while he can be found. If you really feared, you would search for him. He's everywhere. Yahweh can be found while there's still time to care. While he can be found.
Good morning, class. Good morning. Scripture lesson will be taken from Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, page 912. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities in various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, page 912. At the same time, said Yahweh, will I be the Elohim of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus saith Yahweh, the people which were left of the sword found grace in the wilderness, even Israel, when I went to cause him to rest. Yahweh has appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Again I will build thee, and thou shalt be built, O Virgin of Israel. Thou shalt again be adorned with thy tabrets, and shalt go forth in the dances of them that make merry. Thou shalt yet plant vines upon the mountains of Smyrna. The planters shall plant, and shall eat them as common things. For there shall be a day that the watchmen upon the mount of Ephraim shall cry, arise ye, and let us go up to Zion unto Yahweh our Elohim. For thus saith Yahweh, sing with gladness for Jacob, and shout among the chief of the nations. Publish ye, praise ye, and say, O Yahweh, save thy people, the remnant of Israel. Behold, I will bring them from the north country, and gather them from the coasts of the earth, and with them the blind and the lame, the women with child, and her that travaileth with child, together. A great company shall return thither. They shall come with weeping, and with supplication will I lead them. I will cause them to walk by the rivers of waters in a straight way, wherein they shall not stumble, for I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Hear the word of Yahweh, O ye nations, and declare it in the isles afar off, and say, he that scattereth Israel will gather him, and keep him as a shepherd doth his flock. For Yahweh has redeemed Jacob, and ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. Therefore they shall come and sing in the heights of Zion, and shall flow together to the goodness of Yahweh, for wheat, and for wine, and for oil, and for the young of the flock and of the herd. And their souls shall be as a watered garden, and they shall not sorrow any more at all. Then shall the virgin rejoice in the dance, both young men and old together. For I will turn their mourning into joy, and will comfort them, and make them rejoice from their sorrow. And I will satiate the soul of the priests with the fatness, and my people shall be satisfied with my goodness, saith Yahweh. Thus saith Yahweh, a voice was heard in Ramon, lamentations and bitter weeping, Rachel weeping for her children, refused to be comforted for her children because they were not. Thus saith Yahweh, refrain thy voice from weeping, and thy eyes from tears, for the work shall be rewarded, saith Yahweh, and they shall come again from the land of the enemy. And there is hope in thy end, saith Yahweh, that the children shall come again to their own border. I have surely heard Ephraim bemoaning himself thus, thou hast chastened me, and I was chastised as a bullock unaccustomed to the yoke. Turn thou me, and I shall be turned, for thou art Yahweh my Elohim. Surely after that I was turned, I repented, and after that I was instructed. I smote upon my thigh. I was ashamed, yea, even confounded, because I did bear the reproach of my youth. Is not Ephraim my dear son? Is he not a pleasant child? For since I spake against him, I do earnestly remember him still. Therefore, my bowels are troubled for him. I will surely have mercy upon him, said Yahweh. Set thee up way marks, make thee high heaps. Set thy heart towards the highways, even the way which thou wentest. Turn again, O ye virgin of Israel, turn again to these thy cities. How long wilt thou go about, O thy backsliding daughter? For Yahweh has created a new thing in the earth. A woman shall go about seeking a husband. Thus saith Yahweh of hosts, the Elohim of Israel. As yet they shall use this speech in the land of Judah and in the cities thereof when I shall bring again their captivity. Yahweh bless thee, O habitation of justice and mountain of holiness. And there shall dwell in Judah itself and in all the cities thereof together husbandmen and they that go forth with flock. For I have satiated the weary soul and I have replenished every sorrowful soul. Upon this I awake, and behold, and my sleep was sweet unto me. Behold, the days come, said Yahweh, that I will sow the house of Israel, the house of Judah, with the seed of man and with the seed of beast. And it shall come to pass that like as I have watched over them, to pluck up and to break down and to throw down, and to destroy and to afflict. So will I watch over them to build and to plant, saith Yahweh. In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten a sour grape, and the children's teeth are set on edge. But every one shall die for his own iniquity. Every man that eateth the sour grape, his teeth shall be set on edge. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith Yahweh. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know ye Yahweh, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith Yahweh. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Thus saith Yahweh, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinance of the moon and of the stars for a light by night, which divideth the sea when the waves thereof roar. Yahweh of hosts is his name. If those ordinances depart from before me, saith Yahweh, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever. Thus saith Yahweh, if heaven above can be measured, and the foundation of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all that they have done, said Yahweh. Behold, the days come, said Yahweh, that the city shall be built to Yahweh from the tower of Hinel unto the gates of the corner. And the measuring line shall yet go forth over against it upon the hill Garib, and shall compass about to Gath. And the whole valley of the dead bodies and of the ashes, and all the fields unto the brook of Kedron, unto the corners of the horse gate towards the east, shall be holy unto Yahweh. It shall not be plucked up, nor thrown down any more forever. I have read Jeremiah, the 31st chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. For our first speaker today, I would like to call Dr. Samuel Salas.
Thank you. You turned it on already. Yeah, okay. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
I know for a fact Yahweh will give me a strength to stand before you, because I still cannot recover. I am almost 10 months since I have the small stroke, but nevertheless, I am here, and let's see what Yahweh bring to my remember. I remember long time ago, the founder used to say, come to class, put the house in order, and love your brother. Mm-hmm. And I still remember those words. And I still here. And I will remember in this teaching for the longest I live. And the scripture lesson, Jeremiah 31, is very important. Because he was looking into something Yahweh showing him before that happened. He was a man. Yahweh shows him for a purpose to change the Old Testament, the one Moses bring to us, the carnal ordinances. Those carnal ordinances have to be changed forever. Jeremiah is saying, I will write in your heart and in your mind the law, but not the physical one, the new law, spiritual law, because you cannot write into a heart with pencil or ink or pen. Write the laws, no? Jeremiah lived in the days when Judah almost was destroyed. Nabucodonosor, he was ready to destroy Judah. And Jeremiah told the king in those days to surrender and not to fight with Nabucodonosor, because he was very strong. They don't have no chance. But the king don't listen to him, and he was against Nabucodonosor, and he lost. But Nabucodonosor knew Jeremiah, he was telling them not to fight, so he didn't kill him. He pardoned him. He said, hey, don't do not anything to this man, because he was in my side. He told them not to fight, because I will win. And so Jeremiah, in the last moment, he flew to Egypt. Some people tell him, let's get out of here. There is no more chance for us. The power of Nabucodonosor is so great, this Babylonian man. He was the king in those days, the most powerful king in earth. And he flew to Egypt, and Nabucodonosor destroyed Jerusalem and the temple. And the Ark of the Covenant and the temple disappear forever. And nobody knows where the Ark of the Covenant is till now. But since we understand the Ark of the Covenant, there is no value in these days, no more. The Ark of the Covenant is in our mind. This is the Ark of the Covenant. Each one of us have one. And the law is written in our heart, in our mind. When we learn about Yahweh, His purpose, and His plan. The purpose and plan of Yahweh, as we know, it was given to one man, the founder of this school, Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And since then, he started preaching and teaching. See all the charts you see in this room? It's inspiration of Yahweh through him. His name is written right here in this chart. This chart is being called Exodus or Moses chart, because talk too much about Moses. And the first one was the elementary chart, the original one. This is a copy. But you can see plates in this chart. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Those plates are descending and ascending. Mm-hmm. And some are descending and ascending. Mm-hmm. And this is the beauty of this teaching. So clear that our mind is being bombarded with the negative stuff. Wrong teachings, and we had to cast all those things out of our we so-called intelligence on the knowledge we have, because Lucifer is working very hard in those last days, because it's the only chance he have to convert some of the spirits in his side. But here in this school, we have the true teaching, the teaching of Yahweh. Even the world is so simple. The world not know his true name. Mm-hmm. Yes, barely start to know his true name. We have a chart in the wall, and then the names are in there. It's so simple to embrace this teaching. You had to accept the original's names. Without not accepting the original names, you cannot say, "Hey, I believe it." Mm-hmm. No, mm-hmm. It's impossible. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. He revealed to Moses when he was thousands of years in the burning bush. See, we have a chart we call Exodus. It was a little boy called Moses. Yahweh chose him for a purpose. He was 3 months old, but the Pharaoh had a decree to kill all the baby male, thrown to the river. But the mother Jezebel hid Moses, but he was 3 months old. It was too big. He cannot hide him for so long. So he make something like a boat, put some tower around, not to sink, and throw into the Nile River. The Nile River is the one cross Egypt, came from south to north. It's not very common to see a river from south to north. Most of the river come from north to south. And he put the baby in the basket, he threw in the water and told her daughter, she have a daughter and a son besides Moses. Besides, he have Mary and Aaron, a boy and a girl. And he told the girl, chase the boat to see what happened to him. Because she loved the baby so much, was her son. She kept it for 3 months. And the sister followed the little boat and see Pharaoh's daughter taking a shower, and she hear the baby cry, and tell one of the servants, go and get me the boat to see what is in there. The boat was covered, but when she uncovered the little boat, see a baby. And right away, she knew that boy was Hebrew. It's so simple. Why? Because he was circumcised. And there is only two kind of people in those days. Sons Abraham. The people used to be circumcised. And the Gentiles, no one was circumcised. Abraham is the father of the Hebrews, we can say. And the lady know the boy was a Hebrew. She keep it as her son. Give a good education. And he raised as a prince. He lived nice life. But he was 40 years old. Of course, he knew he was a Hebrew, because he see Mary and he see Aaron as his brothers. And one time he was walking in the constructions, inspecting, and he see an Egyptian mistreat a Hebrew. He didn't like that. And he struck the Egyptians. I don't know if he tried to kill or not, but he killed it. After he killed it, he said, what can I do? He make a hole in the ground, the sand, and buried the Egyptian. And he looked everywhere, north, south, east, and west, and he didn't see no one. He said, oh, nobody see me. I am free. So he went home. I will not tell no one what happened. Go to sleep and wake up and come back next day to the same place. And two Hebrews, they were fighting each other. And he tried to be in between. He said, don't fight. And one of them say, who make you a judge over us? Or are you trying to kill us as you killed the Egyptian yesterday? He was astonished. He said, oh, they knew what I did yesterday. Oh, I had to get out of here, otherwise they might kill me. This is assumption of me, what I will say. The Egyptian, it was Pharaoh's son, was mistreating a Hebrew who was Aaron, Moses' brother. So he killed the Egyptian. He didn't kill no regular man. He killed a man being the son of Pharaoh or son of the king. So he went away to the land of Midian. It was a man called Jethro. He ran and became, from being a prince, he became a shepherd for 40 years. Mm-hmm. It's a long time. But one day, he was taking care of the lambs and the goats, and he see a bush and fire. And the bush didn't consume. Mm-hmm. What kind of bush is this? This is what's in his mind. I presume that he think, because I will think this, I think the same. And he went to see around and he was stop, Moses. First of all, take your sandals on your foot, because the land you step in is a holy land. See, we have this chart. Egypt is like go run about. The holy land is the wilderness of Sinai, and the most holy place is Jerusalem. This Jerusalem is physical, where Solomon Temple was built, but this represents Jerusalem above. That representation of this Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Jerusalem above. Of the third heaven, in other words. So Moses see the burning bush, he took the sandals. And it was, he hear a voice in there. He said, Moses, go to Egypt and deliver my people, because I heard the crying of them. They don't feel so good, they be mistreated. And Moses, he make too many excuses not to go. They say, I am a person of small words. I cannot communicate good. Yahweh listened to him and let him speak, and he say, Moses, you have a rod in your hand. Throw on the floor. And Moses obeyed. He threw the rod on the floor. He said, pick it up from the tail. To be honestly, I used to catch serpents in the desert. Very poison. But I have a rod, and I put the rod in the head. I can have the snake from the head, not from the tail. Mm-hmm. Because if I used to have that from the tail, she can come over and bite me,
right,
and kill me. Moses obeyed and took him by the tail, and the serpent became a rod again, showing him who was giving the order has a lot of power. And he said, Moses, put your hand in your bosom. He put the hand in there and he said, get it out. It was white. It was a leprosy. He said, put it back again. Take him out. It was nice and clean, like a regular hand. He said, oh, it's a lot of power. But if I go down there, Moses say, what can I say? Who sent me into them? Because the Hebrew used to know the Creator, the Most High, as El Shaddai, means the Holy Provider. This is the way they knew him. They never heard before, and nobody know the real name was Yahweh. Mm. But before telling him his name was Yahweh, he say, I will be Acher Aya Acha. Aya Acher Aya. That means I will be anything I want to be. So he can change and be something and be something else. No I am than I am, because it's a limitation in that word. You are something and you are something. That's it. Then, but my name is Yahweh. And all the nations should know my name. My name is Yahweh. Go to Pharaoh and tell him to deliver my people for 3 days. They can worship me for 3 days out of Egypt, outside. And don't be afraid, Moses. Your brother is in the way to meet you. So it was so long since Moses knew his brother Aaron, which later on became the first high priest of the Hebrews. Moses went, but when Yahweh told Moses, I hear the cry of my people. He was with them. He was with them in Egypt. Mm-hmm. The one in the burning bush was with them with extra projection. He extra projects himself. And Aaron was in his way, but when Moses left from killing one people in Egypt, 10 years after Moses left, a man appeared in Egypt. His name was Hoshea, the son of Nun. And Hoshea became Moses' minister. Moses. When Yahweh told him in the burning bush, I hear the cry of my people, he was in Egypt with them as a 30 years old man, appeared 30 years old man, and stayed 30 years till the arrival of Moses. When Moses arrived, he started getting old. He was 30, 31, 32 then. But he was between them in Egypt, and he see every day what the way the Egyptians used to treat the Hebrews. And Moses, Yahweh told him, I will show Pharaoh who I am. I will teach him who I am. And Yahweh create 10 devastating plagues. First of all, it turned the waters into blood. Frogs, spiders, rain, fire, famine, all the animals die. Too many things happen in Egypt. And Pharaoh refused to let the Egyptian go. He said, Moses, stop this thing. And Moses come and stop what was happening. But Pharaoh changed his mind all the time. He didn't fulfill what he promised. He said, don't worry, Moses, don't worry. I will send my angel. He will teach them and do, and they will not refuse to let you go. But first of all, you have to do this. In every single house, you have to sacrifice a lamb before 1 year old. Before a year old. With the blood of the lamb, you will paint the door up there and the sides and the basin, leave a little bit of blood. You can see 4 points of blood. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's what they did in every single house, and you paint the door with the blood and from the inside of the house. If you eat the lamb and you have more lamb than supposed to, nobody can finish, give to the neighbor. If you still have some lamb left, burn it. It's what they did. And the angel came in the night, and the firstborn died. Animals and people in the houses, they don't have the 4 points of blood. Next day, all the Egyptians, they were crying, burial of their sons, the firstborn. And Pharaoh say, go, Moses, take your people, go out of here. I don't want you to be here no more. Pharaoh's heart was softened. It was not hard as before, because Yahweh told him in the burning bush, he will harden Pharaoh's heart and not allow the Hebrews go out of Egypt. Now, when they went out of Egypt, when Pharaoh said, get out of here, Yahweh tell Abraham, they will be captive for so long, but they will come out with a lot of substance from Egypt. Mm-hmm. The people, the Hebrew, asked the neighbors, the bosses, for gold, silver, stones, material. And they feel so sorry what's happening. They don't care about physical things. They give away whatever the Hebrews ask for. And they took it and they left. And they went into 3 days' walk. They can go in one way easy. But that was occupied by Palestinians. And they don't want to fight in this time. They went from the other side with the Red Seas. And I want to give the next speaker continue with my tale of this history, of this teaching, because I see I'm getting a little tired. Thank you very much for listening to me. And have a beautiful day and with the continuation of this teaching. Thank you so much.
Hallelujah.
Oh.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Samuel Salas, and I'll be your next speaker for today. We're short ordered today here, but that's all right. I appreciate the remarks from the previous speaker, and it is definitely an honor and a privilege to be able to stand before the assembly of the body of Yahshua the Messiah and speak of anything that I've come to know and understand of this great teaching. That was, as the last speaker said, that was given as a result of a divine vision and revelation, and a divine vision and a divine revelation, given to the founder of this school, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. The previous speaker was explaining the migratory trek or journey according to the promise that was given to Abraham. And Abraham was given a promise, as the previous speaker said, that his seed would inherit this promised land, Jerusalem, or Canaan land. But only after being cast into a land that they knew not of, and being evilly entreated for 400 years, as the previous speaker already explained. Now, he's got us all the way up to the 10 devastating plagues having been poured out, and that death angel already passing over, them having taken out that lamb, striking the four corners of their the door, having that lamb in them, and now they're on their three-day journey to the Red Sea. And where the previous speaker left off was, there's another way that they could have went. When Moses fled out of Egypt the first time he went, he didn't go to the deep end of the Red Sea. He fled out of Egypt by the trade route. He went around to where there was a low tide at, and you could get across to get up here into the wilderness of Sinai. Now, the Jews, these Hebrews, they didn't go that way. As his previous speaker was saying, they didn't want any conflict with the Palestinians or anyone else along that trade route. So they went the hard way. And they came to the Red Sea, to the deep end. And when they got to this Red Sea, by the time they got to this Red Sea, Pharaoh's, whose heart was softened momentarily, had been hardened again. When Pharaoh realized his kingdom had been all but destroyed, he wouldn't have anybody to build any more of his kingdom, his treasure cities. He would have to incorporate his own people to do so. And they were travailing in pain from the loss of the firstborn of every household in that nation. Pharaoh waxed angry and went all or nothing.
if you will, and gathered all of the chariots and his armies and pursued after those Israelites. Now, those Israelites, not really knowing what's going on, they just knowing that these plagues had been poured out. Moses is telling them what to do. Moses is telling them to have some faith because Yahweh is, you know, working with them, and he's bringing them out of this bondage that they're in. But they don't realize what kind of bondage they're in. And that is a representation of the work of the adversary. True deception is the deception that you don't really know that you're in. You don't know that it's happening. Now, they're coming to the shore of the Red Sea here. Pharaoh and his armies are barreling down on them. And they say, why you bring us out here to the Red Sea to die? We could have stayed down here in Egypt and served in the Pharaoh and lived. But Pharaoh was persecuting them every chance he had an opportunity. He was going to kill them off. They were under a death decree. They weren't going to have any liberty, any freedom, being down here in Egypt. But they were so blinded by the flesh that they would rather be imprisoned and evilly entreated than to rise up and make their exit out of this bondage. So they get to the Red Sea, and Moses doesn't know what to do because Moses isn't doing any of this in the first place. This is Yahweh, as it said in the moderation, when Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, Moses didn't lead anybody anywhere. Right. Yahweh did this. So Moses turns to his minister, Joshua, or Yahoshua, or Hoshea. However, I believe it was Yahoshua. And he asked him, you know, what to do. And Yahoshua said, what were you looking at me for? You know, raise your staff up, part these waters, and the Red Sea heaped up. Heaped up like St. Louis Arch type style. You can go underneath it. And those children of Israel, they went through the divided waters of those Red Sea on dry ground. Pharaoh and his armies followed through. And there was a cloud that went before those children of Israel and behind them. So they were in the midst of that cloud as they went through that Red Sea. And that cloud was light unto the Jews, but it was darkness unto those Gentiles or those Egyptians. And they followed behind those Jews. And once they were in the Red Sea, they were swallowed up. Now, those Jews got to the other side. And once they made it to the shore of the other side, they began to see all those Egyptians, Pharaoh and his entire host, washing up on the shore dead. So when you look at the Charlton Heston movie, it's inaccurate at the end when you see Pharaoh on his throne saying the Lord God is the true Lord God, because he wasn't around to say anything after those children of Israel went through the divided waters of the Red Sea. He went in and he died along with his army, being overthrown completely and destroyed, representing that mystery of iniquity being destroyed. Now, that wasn't the end for Satan, because those tormented souls made their way into these children of Israel. Now, it's not hard to understand how that could have happened, because you can see the same manifestation of something like that happening when a child is adopted into a family. They go from one family that has one disposition in the way that they act and carry themselves, and then they're displaced from this family and that disposition, and then they move into another family with a different disposition. And eventually, over time, that child will start to pick up those characteristics, those attributes, even carry themselves the same way as that new family, sometimes to the extent that you can't tell that they're not really family, that they're not genetically attached to each other. The same thing happened with these children of Israel. They were down here in this bondage for so long under the customs, the traditions of the people of this land, that those customs and traditions and those perversions followed over here to the other side of the Red Sea into the wilderness. They were steeped in their carnality of their theories, concepts, and opinions of how things were to be. Now, this promise was given Romans, I think it's 5, the 5th chapter in the 3rd verse. Now, this promise was given because sin was in the earth. There had been a law that was given to Adam. And that law was, that commandment was just to not partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil when he was in the Garden of Eden. Now, Adam transgressed that law, and death fell on all the earth. And during this whole time, the children of Israel, Abraham, Noah, so on and so forth, Adam all the way down up to this time, death reigned. And the people were in a constant state, a perpetual state of condemnation. And they did not have an escape at this time. So Yahweh gave Abraham this promise that his seed would be blessed, and put his lineage through all of this in order to give his people a way of escape out of this state of condemnation. Do you got Romans? I think it's 5 and...
You say 5 and 3?
Yeah, I think... What is that? Let me see.
And not only so, but we glory in tribulation. As by one man sin into the world?
I think so. Yeah, what is that?
That's Romans 5:12.
Where it says, let me see.
Nevertheless, death reigned from
Yeah. Him. Yeah, give me that.
You want me to start at the thought? Or just want the script?
5 and 12. Yes, at the beginning of the thought. Yeah.
Wherefore, Romans 5:12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world.
That's what I wanted. Yeah.
And death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
All have sinned by the transgression of the law that Adam had transgressed. Death passed upon the whole world. Mm-hmm. Now we need to come up out of that state. We want to come up out of that state, and there's no way. Go ahead and let's continue to read here.
For until the law, sin was in the world, mm-hmm. but sin is not imputed where there is no law.
So, for until the law, sin was in the world, but the sin is not imputed where there is no law. Mm-hmm. Read.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come.
Death reigned from Adam all the way to Moses. Death reigned to Moses because Moses was given this law. And if one could complete this entire law, then that would be unto their righteousness. Death would no longer have a dominion over them if one could complete this law. Now, none of these Jews could complete or fulfill this entire 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances. So it necessitated the lawmaker to come in and fulfill it for them, to complete it for the people. And what this law did was it made sin exceedingly sinful because it attached something to impute that law to. As it was read in the 12th, I think, in the 13th verse, yeah, it says, sin is not imputed when there is no law. Mm-hmm. So before this law was given to Moses, there was sin in the world, but it wasn't imputed on them because they didn't have any way of escape. They didn't have anything to get up out of that state of condemnation. So that gives Yahshua somebody to go back and preach to.
Right.
Now, these Jews, they cross the Red Sea, they go into the wilderness of Sinai, and they're told to prepare themselves because Yahweh was going to give them a law. Mm-hmm. So they prepared themselves, and Moses went up on the mount, and there was three trips that Moses went in up on the mount. The first trip up onto the mount, he was given the Ten Commandment law. Okay? The Jews, the Israelites, they heard the thunderings and they were fearful of Yahweh. They didn't want Yahweh to speak to them anymore. They said, all this that Yahweh thunders down, we're going to do it. Just don't let him speak to us. You speak for us, for him, because we can't handle it. It's too much for them. So Moses comes down and he's told that he's to come up again a second time. And this second time that Moses comes up, the first time he goes up is you read about in Exodus, the 19th chapter. And the second time he goes up, you read up in Exodus, the 24th chapter. Now, this second time he goes up, he's told to go alone and by himself. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh was going to hew out a law. That law, he was going to write it on tables of stone for him. He was going to be given that law on tables. And Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu were supposed to come to the plateau of the mount. About halfway up, Moses alone would go all the way up to the top of the mount, into the cloud. And the 70 elders would be back nigh lower than Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu. Now, Moses was to be up in this mount for 40 days and 40 nights.
Right.
And we were talking about on Thursday, Dr. Reiser was talking about that second trip up onto the mount. What, that's 24 and 15?
Yep, 16.
Go ahead and start. Go ahead and start at 13, actually.
Oh, 13?
Yeah, give me 13. Because Moses, like it was said, Moses was in the first or second verses told that Moses was supposed to go up alone. Mm-hmm. Well, go ahead and read.
Exodus 24:13. Mm-hmm. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua. Mm-hmm. And Moses went up into the mount of Elohim. Mm-hmm. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us until we come again unto you.
Now, that would seem as if Moses was being disobedient if you didn't know who his minister Joshua was. His minister Joshua was Yahshua. Mm-hmm. He was Yahweh being made manifest in concrete form in a body as his minister. Mm-hmm. Joshua.
Right.
He was serving Moses, and he was serving all of these Jews by putting together this law for them to follow so that they could have a way to righteousness. He was ministering unto their souls. Mm-hmm. They just weren't aware of it.
Right.
Moses said, tarry ye here for us. And the one that called him up into the mount to come alone and by himself was his minister, Joshua.
Right.
Now continue reading, please.
And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Mm-hmm. If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai. And the cloud covered it 6 days,
and
colon.
The cloud covered it 6 days, colon.
Right.
Now, there should be an explanation of what happened those 6 days, but there's not right here.
Right.
The explanation of what happens on this 6 days happens in Genesis.
Genesis 1 and 1.
Right.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
So Moses was called up onto this mount, and the glory of Yahweh abode on the top of this mount, and the cloud covered this mount for 6 days, and during that first 6 days, Moses saw the first 6 days of the creation in a vision. Mm-hmm. The creation of the earth, as you will. Continue back in Exodus 24 and 16.
And 16. Mm-hmm. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. That's what you see here. You've got the glory of Yahweh abiding here. You've got the 6 days of the creation. And you've got Yahweh Elohim calling out to Moses out of the midst of the cloud over here. Now, Moses was in that, read on down to where, how long he was in there.
And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in mm-hmm. the eyes of the children of Israel.
It was consuming devouring, consuming are synonymous with each other. Mm-hmm. It was consuming the theories, the concepts, and the opinions of what Moses thought that he knew about anything. Mm-hmm. Read.
And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. Mm-hmm. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
He was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. And then that's the beginning of the 25th chapter right there, right?
Right.
Okay. So for the next five chapters or so, the explanation of this tabernacle and how it is to be constructed in detail is drawn out. And that's what you got going on here after that colon. You've got Genesis 1, the first chapter of Genesis, explaining the first 6 days of the creation to where Adam and Eve were in righteousness, peace, and joy in the garden. And then Yahweh called Moses' attention away from Adam and Eve in righteousness, peace, and joy, resting in the garden to show him this tabernacle in detail mm-hmm. for the remaining 33 days that Moses was up in that mount. This is very important because this gives us an understanding of the purpose and the pattern and the plan of Yahweh, our Elohim, in this second trip up into the mount. It's very, very important. Now, when Moses was up in the mount, his minister, Joshua, called him down from the mount, saying that there was rumors of war. Can we get that?
Fifteen. Mm-hmm. And Moses turned and went down from the mount, and the two tables of the testimony was in his hand. The tables was written on both sides, on the one side and on the other, where they were written. And the tables was the work of Elohim, and the writings were the writing of Elohim graven upon the tables. Mm-hmm. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, "There is noise of war in the camp." Mm-hmm. And he said, "It is not the voice of them that shout for mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome, mm-hmm. but the noise of them that sing do I hear." And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing. And Moses' anger grew hot, and he cast the tables out of his hand and brake them beneath the mount.
Now, Moses was aware of what was going on. In his vision, he seen Adam and Eve in this state of righteousness, peace, and joy. And that's where his vision stopped in his second trip into the mount. And he began to get the instructions for the tabernacle. And while he was up there, Yahweh hewed out that table of stone, seven laws on one side, three on the other. Mm-hmm. And he come. Now, his minister calls him down from this mountain and says, "Hey, these people are partying down here. They're dancing, they're worshiping this golden calf." Now, on the first trip that Moses was called up, they were given this law that was written down here. They were given this law. Mm-hmm. And the people said, "All this that Yahweh said will do." Mm-hmm. Now, the second trip up, Moses goes up, and they break the law immediately As soon as he goes up into the mountain, he's gone for longer than what they feel is okay. They figure Moses is dead or whatever, and they call unto Aaron to make them a god to worship that they can say brought them out of that land of Egypt. And they feel like there's nothing wrong with Aaron doing that because he was an idol maker. And Moses said, if you got anything to do, go to Aaron or her.
Right. Yeah.
So they get this golden calf out here. They're worshiping, orgy, whatever. Whatever's going on, Moses sees them worshiping this golden calf. They see that he sees this graven image, and he gets mad at the people because he's up here learning and gathering this information to bring back to these people, and they just went on ahead about their own business like none of this is important. So he breaks those tables of stone, and it had to be that way. Because those tables of stone being broke represents that first law being broken. So Moses has to come back up again into the mount for the third time. Can you read where that is, where he's commanded to go up the third time, please?
Exodus 34 and 1. And Yahweh said unto Moses, hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first.
Now, this first two tables of stone, Yahweh hewed out himself. This second table of stone, Moses got to do himself. Mm-hmm. Moses has got to do these ones because he done broke it. Now Moses has got to do it.
Yep.
Now, that's important because it's just like what we were talking about with Matthew 11 and 27. All ye that are heavy laden in labor, you come unto Yahshua. The first time around, Yahweh, he coming down to you. But since you don't want to follow his law, well, now you got to come to him.
Yep.
All right. Now, continue reading there where you are and hew thee out those two tables of stone.
And I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest.
Right.
And be ready in the morning and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai and present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. And no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man seem throughout all the mount, neither let the flocks nor herd feed before the mount. And he hewed two tables of stone like unto the first. And Moses rose up early in the morning and went up unto Mount Sinai. Okay. And Yahweh had commanded him and took in his hand the two tables of stone. And Yahweh descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of Yahweh. And Yahweh passed by before him and proclaimed, Yahweh, Yahweh El, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundance and goodness and truth. Keeping mercy for thousand, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children's children, unto the third and to the fourth generation. And Moses made haste and bowed his head towards the earth and worshiped. And he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Yahweh, let my Elohim, I pray thee, go among us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us from thy inheritance. And he said, behold, I make a covenant. Before all thy people I will do marvels, such as have not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation. And all the people among which thou art shall see the work of Yahweh, for it is a terrible thing that I will do with thee. Observe thou that which I have commanded thee this day. Behold, I drive out before thee the Amorites, the Canaanites, and the Hittites, Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites.
So, So he's making this covenant, which is to serve as a kingdom for these Jews. All right? And he's telling them that he's going to drive out all of the inhabitants of this land of Canaan so that those Jews can inherit that land. Now, we're not going to have time to go through the entire story, but when you fast forward later on, there were members, a member from each one of the tribes sent up here to spy out the land. They were only supposed to be out here in this wilderness for 40 days. Well, since they didn't believe the report of Joshua and Caleb that they could overtake the giants and whatever was going on up here in this land, they were told that they had to stay out here for 40 years. Mm-hmm. Because they just didn't have any faith in Yahweh. Now, this third trip that Moses, and this is why I wanted to get this third trip of Moses, he was given a recapitulation of, or recap, or a rerun, however you want to say it, of what he's seen in the second trip into the mount. Mm-hmm. And except this time, he's seen the transgression of Adam and Eve,
right,
in the garden. He's seen Satan entice Eve and her partake of that fruit, that forbidden fruit, and give it to her husband, and him partake of the fruit and die willingly for her, drawing out all of this that's happening, that's taking place. From in Adam, all men die, and then death passed over all the world, and you got Noah in the flood because the world was wicked, and Yahweh destroyed the world, and he made a covenant with Noah that were with the earth, that he would never destroy the earth again by water. And that's the bow in the sky, the rainbow. And when you look at the rainbow, when you turn on your garden hose, because we got running water and we got garden hose, you can see the rainbow form in the sunlight from the midst of the water. Mm-hmm. And there was never any rain before that flood, so there wasn't a rainbow there to be in the sky.
Really?
So that's consistent with that being a sign of the covenant, that there would, you know, he puts his bow in the sky as a symbol that he won't destroy the earth by water again. Now, some people have taken that covenant and perverted it into something else, some equal rights movement type situation, but that's not what that rainbow is really supposed to represent. People are going to do whatever they want, whatever.
It's a covenant.
Now, the earth won't be destroyed by water anymore. This time is going to be destroyed by fire, which I don't know which is worse. Destroyed is destroyed, but fire, you know, there's nothing left over after fire. I guess water would probably be a lighter sentence than fire. Nevertheless, death still reigned after the flood. The people replenished the earth, and all of these things took place. Moses was called up into this mount three times and given this law. And was given the information to write the first five books of your Bible, the law. And as a result of a divine vision and a divine revelation, Moses had by way of Yahweh Elohim. Now, that is why Moses is so important in these scriptures, is because Moses was the first one to have the name of Yahweh. Abraham had a vision. Moses had visions. Job had visions. Isaac had visions. All of his forefathers had visions. The patriarchs, they had visions, but they didn't know Yahweh. They didn't know Yahweh by his name. They didn't know anything about his purpose. They didn't have this pattern, this tabernacle, as a schoolmaster to show them how they are made in his likeness and image. Now, at this time, he was given this law, and now there's something concrete that was given to Yahweh's people so that you could know something about him. And as I said before, this was a kingdom, standing, meaning king's dominion. Yahweh had rule over these people by way of this pattern of this by this tabernacle. Mm-hmm. If one of those laws were broken, they were to sacrifice onto the altar to make an atonement for whatever that sin may be. Now, John 5:39.
Mm-hmm. Ye search the scriptures, for in them you think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Mm-hmm. But ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you. Mm-hmm. I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Now, I want to stop right there. We come down to this school, and in the moderation, we explain the true and correct name and title of our Heavenly Father. Mm-hmm. Right. Yahweh being the name of our Heavenly Father in his pure spirit state. Yahweh Elohim being that intermediate state of Yahweh in super incorporeal form. And Yahshua being the Holy Spirit, whether in a body or out of a body. Okay? Now, you've got two mysteries in operation, and you've got that mystery of righteousness, which is Yahshua, and you've got a perversion of that, which is likened unto that angel of light that you see over here. You've got Adam in the garden, and you've got Lucifer in the garden here. Now, Lucifer was cast out, never no more to return. And he operates according to the same pattern that Yahweh Elohim declared from the beginning, except he perverts every principle of that pattern because he's hiding the true so-called nature of Yahweh. And he's doing his job in doing that, in hiding the nature of Yahweh. So, he's a bad guy, not such a bad guy, according to Yahweh. He's doing what he's supposed to do. But we ain't got a chance. Man does not have a chance against that adversary. It takes Yahweh himself making his righteous principles manifest in you to know something of his purpose. And without that, the devil got you. And we explain these names, Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And I personally came out of the church. I thought I was Baptist, but half the time, and it just depended on whatever the girl I was dating was, I would just go to her church. You know, that's pretty much where I was at. I was Pentecostal one day. I was, you know, whatever. Like I said, but I did believe in something. I knew that there was something higher than me and even the pastor or the Pope. You know, I just knew that there was something that as a higher power, and I didn't know exactly what it was. Now, I remember being in the church, and I remember people, you know, trying to get me to get more involved into the church, and I did. But there was just always something that just didn't click. It just wasn't right. It just seemed like there was a big question mark. And it's funny because, let me see, just stay right there, just stay right there. Hmm. No, I know we got. Okay. We started a little bit late, so we can go. Now I would be in church, and I would hear the pastor say something that I like to hear, and I'd get an exclamation point right on. But overall, before the sermon was over with, I'll have a question mark. What does that even mean? Like, what does all of this mean? And I just never was satiated, as it was talked about in the scripture lesson. I was never satisfied by what was given by preacher, the priest, or the pastor, wherever I went, to learn something about my Heavenly Father. And when I came into this school, I was told these names, Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And I accepted them. One of the reasons why I accepted them is because I had done some research, and I had knew already that the original Hebrew name of our Heavenly Father was Yahweh. So that wasn't hard for me to accept. What was hard for me to accept, or harder, was Yahshua. Because I was raised believing in Jesus. And everybody around me believed in Jesus. Even the Jehovah's Witnesses believed in Jesus, the Mormons, the Quakers, everybody around me, the denominations of the church, the Roman Catholics, all believing in Jesus. I had never heard of the name Yahshua before. But I knew that the name was Yahweh. And what I'm talking about right now is, it says right here, I am come in my Father's name. Mm-hmm. Read 43 again.
I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not.
I am come in my, this is the Messiah speaking. He said, I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. Mm-hmm. Now, I've invited people. I've told people about this class. I've given links to the YouTube and links to the Zoom and so on, the address, everything. It takes Yahweh in order to bring somebody down here.
That's right.
Because as far as I can see, Jesus has no similitude to Yahweh. And Lord is clearly and obviously a title. There's this thing going on right now. In Scotland, you can buy a 1 square foot parcel of land and be declared a lord.
Oh.
They're selling it. They're selling land, 1 square foot, and you can have the title of a lord. Mm. By and that's really what a lord is a landowner. It's a title. Lord such and such of the such and such clan. But it's not a name. And he says, I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. Read.
Let another come in his own name, him you will receive.
Mm-hmm.
How can ye believe which receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that cometh from Elohim only?
Now, what I realize in the church is you receive honor one of another. You have Pastor's Appreciation Day. Mm-hmm. You have the Youth Pastor's Day. You have the Rising Stars Day. You've got the people who do the little mime dancing around, whatever they call that, praise dancing. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah. You got the praise dancers. They receive honor for doing their little shows. Yeah. They put together programs where they have plays and things like that. So they receive honor from one another with that. They raise money, have fundraisers, and hand out food to the poor who don't go to the church, and then hand out pieces of paper. This is the church that we go to.
Yeah.
Come on down here, and they feel real good. I done gave you some chips and some soda and some hot dogs, and it's free, and that came out of my pocket, and you didn't have to do anything. You should appreciate that. And they feel good. They pat themselves on the back. They receive their honor all because, from one another. But they don't seek the honor that come from Yahweh Elohim according to his purpose. Mm-hmm. And that's important. Read.
Mm-hmm. Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust. For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me. For he wrote of me.
If you believe Moses and what he wrote, then you would believe Yahshua the Messiah and what Yahshua the Messiah is doing. If you would have believed Moses. Read.
Hmm. But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words?
How are you going to believe anything of Yahshua the Messiah if you don't believe what Moses? They got so steeped in their carnality, they might as well have been back down here in Egypt with the tabernacle. Because they didn't, the scribes and the Pharisees then built this thing up, and they didn't made it to attain to their own righteousness. I know I'm about out of time here.
Okay.
And they just took away the name of Yahweh for Adonai. They took away the name, and they just didn't believe, and that's the state and condition that we're in right now, down at the end of this age, continually. And it's all drawn out for us so that we can know our physical body operates the same way as the trek of Abraham's seed down into Egypt and back up into the promised land. That's why when you have a thought and you take your finger and you touch something, that signal goes from your brain down to your finger to touch something, and then a signal goes back from your finger back up to your brain so that you can feel that sensation of what you just touched, being, as the first speaker said, descending and ascending in like manner, mm-hmm. all the way through. That's true. You've got 63 generations coming down before Yahshua, just like you've got 63 nerves coming down from your brain. Mm-hmm. I mean, there is so much to this. I'm out of time, but this pattern is important to investigate, to correlate to everything. And this first law was given, and the whole reason why I even started and I followed in with what the first speaker was talking about, this first law was given so that you could know something about Yahweh when he showed up to fulfill this law. And that's what Yahshua the Messiah did, not Jesus the Christ. Yahshua the Messiah, he walked the earth playing 3.5 years in his ministry, fulfilling this entire law that was given from the mount to Moses, completing it. He died. He was buried. He resurrected. He ascended. And he poured out his Holy Spirit on Pentecost to 120. The last time I got on the floor, I said 12. I apologize. I made a mistake. It was 120 in the upper room. They went out to the four corners of the world preaching the gospel. For 7 years, those Jews that believed the report received the Holy Spirit. And then, if you can just give me... in Cornelius' house in Caesarea, that gospel was preached by Peter to those Gentiles, and they believed the report. And at that point in time, that same Holy Spirit, that same promise that was given to first to the Jews, was then given to the Gentiles. And that's where we're at right now. And we're coming down here to this school, preaching the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, in hopes that you believe the report and you can be saved. The 10th aim of this school is to inherit eternal life now. Right. We want you to know that that flyleaf in your book, that so-called New Testament from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to Revelations, that is not the New Testament. The New Testament is written in your heart and mind. It's not in a book. It's not in pen and ink. And you receive that new covenant by learning of Yahshua and believing on him and having faith that through him all things are possible. I hope something that was said was gotten out of this class. And if so, all praises be to Yahweh, our Elohim, through his only begotten son, Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Today's class is come to an end. The only announcement that I know that we have is we will not be holding in-person classes here from the 18th, I believe Thursday is the 18th, and the 21st of this month, August, as the majority of our members will be out of town at the Unity and Yah Symposium that's upcoming. So just mark that on your calendars that we won't be having classes here. And if any of us who stays behind would like to go and visit Pomona, then I'm more than willing to do some chauffeuring or whatnot for that. We can go to class that way. But other than those days, we hold classes here normally on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California. And we urge you to bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truly the place where you can learn something truthful about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh, in order to save your soul. Let's all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.